Suggestions for determining U and DV when setting up integration by parts. Try allowing DV to equal the most complicated portion of your integrand that fits a basic integration rule, and you might have to play around with it a little bit just to make it match. Of course, we understand integration by now. Or try allowing U to equal the factor of the integrand whose derivative is simpler than U. So you wouldn't want, if you had a factor which was, say, e to the 2x, you wouldn't want to allow that to be u, because the derivative of e to the 2x is going to be 2 times e to the 2x. That's not simpler, okay? So dv, when you're setting up your little equations on the side to get this integration by parts, the process going, dv will always include the dx, because you're going to have to integrate that part, equation to find out what v is going to be equal to, and thus it makes sense to have the dx go along with it. Once you choose dv, the remaining factor or factors are going to be u, or vice versa. If you choose u, the rest is going to be dv. Now, again, and I'm going to be highlighting this throughout all, I think, five examples I said I was going to do in this particular lesson. You may use the, I think I said Liotte, but Liotte, the acronym, Liotte, to help choose your U. And you go down this acronym with L for logarithm, so like the natural log of X or common log of X or whatever. Inverse trig functions, if you have a factor which is, which is an inverse trigonometric function, like the inverse sine of X, then that would be a good place to start trying to figure out what would be the best, you know, factor to allow it to be equal to U. Then, do you have any algebraic parts or factors to your integrand, like x to the 13th power or x to the n? And then trigonometric parts, like sine of the x or cosine of x. And then finally, any exponential parts, just as an example, like 4 to the x. So you go down this acronym in this sequence, and there are other, actually there's other variations to this, other acronyms that can help you figure out what factor of your integrand is going to be best to set equal to u, but I like this one, and plus it's kind of fun to say Liotte as I go through this entire lesson. So let's get on to our first two examples. Example number 5. Let's take the indefinite integral of x squared times sine of 7x dx. Well, we should be able to do this already. This looks a lot like example number 3. So pause the video, give it a shot. I'll step out, reveal the solution one step at a time, and see where we lead. Is this exactly like number 3, or is this a little bit different? Okay, so yeah, this all started off looking like example number 3. We had an algebraic portion or factor to our integrand following the Liotte rule here, or acronym. That was, of course, the third letter in the acronym, algebraic portion. So we let that equal u, and the derivative of u, or du, is 2x dx. Just dropping that power down, we let the rest of that integrand equal dv. We integrated both sides. We had the indefinite integral of sine of 7x dx. We needed to let 7x be u. The derivative of that is 7x, so we need to finish that chain rule, introduce a multiplication of 7, balance it with a division of 7, or multiplication of 1/7, and the indefinite integral of sine is negative cosine. So we have v is equal to negative 1/7 cosine of 7x. And then setting up, or going through our rule for integrating by parts, we have our u, v, giving us negative x squared over 7 cosine of 7x minus the indefinite integral of negative 1/7 times cosine of 7x times 2x dx. And the 2 and the negative 1/7, they come together, and I pulled it out front, that constant out front, giving us basically the same thing, but a plus 2/7 in front of the indefinite integral symbol. Well, at this point, with all these other examples, I was ready to just continue the indefinite integration process and be done. But if I let u equal 7x, the derivative of u is equal to 7, and I have 7x, and I have, 7 dx. So I have that dx. I could easily introduce a multiplication of 7, but I have that extra x in there, that factor of x, which means that really, Yeah, we went through the integration, identifying you and DV and this and setting up the integration of parts process, but we need to do it again. Okay, so let's step off, re-identify what we're going to let U, which is just going to be the X, and DV be the cosine of 7x dx, and go through this process again and see if we can't break this up even more with another step of integration by parts. Now, if I just continue this problem on, I'm definitely going to run out of room, so I'm going to go ahead and erase this portion of my work and slide this line up to line number 2 and go through the integration of parts process again, identifying what U and DV is going to be equal to, and then reveal after that the rest of the solution. So pause the video if you want to work out the rest of this problem on your own. So as you can see, and hopefully you did as well, we set up a new U and DV, U being X, that given you DU is simply DX, and with DV being the cosine of 7x dx, we integrate both sides of that. We had to again finish that chain rule process, so putting a 7 out here and a division of 7 to cancel that out, and the integral of cosine is equal to sine, so we have V is equal to 1/7 sine of 7x dx. Now, as we start to apply the integration rule, integration by parts rule again, we're going to have that uv minus the indefinite integral of v du. Now, we've done this now, what? We're in the fifth example. Why am I saying it again? Just to remind you one more time that you're taking what is basically 2/7 times a single term, and you're breaking it up into two terms. Now, it's a positive 2/7, so if you, for some reason, well, even if you did forget the brackets, you would then not distribute the 2/7 through both of those terms. You know, it was 2/7 times one term. Now, applying the integration by parts, it's 2/7 times two terms, and of course, you need to distribute that to get the correct answer. So make sure you use parentheses or brackets every time you do substitution. And let's see here. Well, when I distributed that through, we had 2 times negative 1 is negative 2/7, but then I also pulled that 1/7 out front, so that's where the denominator 49 came from. It's 7 times 7 is equal to 49, just like it was here in the first term, but just pulling that out in front of the integral symbol, just wanted to point that out. Now, again, you'll look over here and we have negative 2 over 49 in front of our indefinite integral symbol, and now we have negative 2 over 3, 43. Well, there's no coefficient of 7 here in front of the sine, and again, we need to complete that chain rule pattern. So I introduce a multiplication of 7 and a division of 7, or a multiplication of 1/7, and 49 times 7 is 343. So let's see, we just integrated basically sine. The integral of sine is negative cosine, so we have a sine change there, and this is a perfectly fine answer. If it were not to match what you got out of your CAS system, or if it was a similar type problem in your textbook and you look in the back and it looks totally different, I'm just finding common denominators, multiplying this by 49 in the numerator and denominator, multiplying this by 7. And because we have a couple of terms with the cosine of 7x, I also did a little reordering and wrote negative 49x squared cosine of 7x plus 2 cosine 7x plus 14x sine of 7x, and I factored this common factor out of the first two terms of cosine of 7x, and we get here our final answer. So we are coming up to our last example. Very exciting. Well, stop mumbling. Let's get to it right now. It's the last example number 6, and let's find the indefinite integral of e to the 2x cosine of 3x dx. Do we have, looking at latte, last time in the video, I'm going to say that. Do we have a logarithm? No. Do we have an inverse trig function? No. Do we have an algebraic part? No, not really. I mean, there's some variables and stuff floating around, but you know, we don't have like a 3x or something, or x to the fourth. Do we have a trigonometric factor or part? Yes, we do, cosine of 3x. So we're gonna let u equal the cosine of 3x. And that means that dv is the remainder, and the dv again has to have that dx, even though it's there with the cosine, it seems like. We're gonna let dv equal e to the 2x dx. Now that means that if we take the derivative of u, du is gonna be over here. The derivative of cosine is negative sine. But we have that inside function of 3x. We're gonna multiply that by 3, of course. We're going to integrate both sides of this to figure out what v is gonna be equal to. So v is gonna be equal to the indefinite integral of e to the 2x dx. And we've been doing enough of these now. I'm just leaving some space to fill in the chain rule. The derivative of 2x is 2, so we need to finish that chain rule and have a one out front, one half out front to balance that out. And we get v is equal to 1/2 e to the 2x, because of course, again, the integral of e to the u is e to the u, or integral of e to the u du is e to the u. Okay, well, we've got everything we need. Let's see here. We have uv, so we have uv. Okay, so we have, let's see here, we have 1/2. Let's see, let's put the e first, I guess. E to the 2x. So there's, well, it's uv, but I know that I'm going to kind of end up with that same sort of format as the original problem. So I'm putting v first. So vu or uv minus the indefinite integral of v du. Okay, we have some constants here. This is going to be negative 3/2. We're going to pull that out front. And negative times negative is positive, and that 3 over 2. Well, I'm kind of getting into, I went through the integration of parts process, and I actually have something more complicated than it looks like when I started with, and I guess that kind of always happens with your uv and the plus integral of v du. Well, if we go through this integration by parts process again, and we let the trig function be u again, the derivative of sine is cosine. So I don't think we're going to get a simpler expression, but it seems like since the, you know, the way how we integrate or take the derivative of e to the x is e to the x, and it's there, and at least we're going to get back to cosine. Let's just go through the integration of parts process one more time and see if we lead to a point, you know, that, I don't know, can make any sense out of this, because right now it seems like we did a lot of work and didn't make a whole lot happen. Oh, and by the way, I forgot to mention on the previous example at the end of it, I'm doing these six examples. Like I said, we're going to do a definite integration video again, do another video that requires maybe a little bit of u substitution incorporated with the integration by parts. We're also going to do another lesson that's specifically like the problem in the example number 5. There's a particular type of pattern that you can have in your integrand that would give you a hint that the problem would be easier or much quicker to do by something called a tabular method or the tic-tac-toe method, if you ever watched the movie Stand By Me. So we'll have that was the exponent on the x, it was only x squared. We only had to go through two steps of the integration by parts. If that had been an x to the fourth or fifth, it would have been a much longer, tedious process, and we'll talk about those in a later lesson. But for right now, again, getting back to this, we did an integration by parts process. We got to a new line. Doesn't seem that much different than the previous one. Let's do it one more time and see what happens. This time, you give it a shot. So we have our new u. It's going to be sine of 3x. And that means that du is going to be 3 cosine of 3x dx, going through the chain rule. Dv is going to be the same e to the 2x dx. So we have v is, once again, 1 half e to the 2x power. So, you know, going through our integration by parts process again, we have the same first term right here, plus 3 over 2. So plus 3 over 2 again, but now this is going from one term to 2. So we're, of course, remembering to use those parentheses as we set up or work through the integration by parts rule, or, you know, take this out and substitute it with two terms. This is just, you know, not getting that much simpler. Except, I've just noticed something here, that if I were to take this 3 halves out and move it in front of the indefinite integral symbol, move the constant out front, if you will, well, then look at what I've got. In my work, I have the indefinite integral of e to the 2x cosine of 3x dx, and that was my original problem. Well, I didn't really do all this work to get right back to where I started from, and I didn't. It's that expression is within my work. Well, how are we going to finish this problem? Well, recognizing that this is equal to this whole, long expression here, I'm going to make an equation. This is equal to this. Great. I'm going to write them so that they're equal to each other. And, you know, basically think of way back in, you know, algebra, where you were solving an equation where you had a variable on both sides of the equation. I'm going to move this, indefinite integral of e to the 2x cosine of 3x dx to the other side of the equation and, you know, do a little bit of work, and I'll be able to isolate that, and whatever's on the right-hand side is going to be our final answer. We're kind of going in a circle here. But that also means that if I'm saying that I'm going to write these equal to each other, I need a big, long equation, and I do apologize. I try and always have my notes really neat and have them all up on the board by the end so you can follow the sequence of work, but I'm going to erase all of the scratch work where I'm setting up u and dv to go through the integration by parts process and kind of squeeze this up a little bit so I can have, you know, so I can write the rest of these notes neatly so you can follow them. Here we go. So cleaning up all of our scratch work, setting up those integration by parts, I've got the answer to the first step of integration by parts here, and then the end of our second step, and then that's when we identified, chalk down, that we had e to the 2x cosine 3x dx showing up again. So I took our original problem, I set it equal to that place in our work, and I moved this term. I added 9 over 4 times the definite integral e to the 2x cosine of 3x dx. I added that to both sides, and 1 plus 9 over 4 with common denominators is 13 over 4. And now, you know, all I have left to do is multiply both sides of the equation by all I have left to do. I mean, look how much work we had to do, but and being very careful with my signs and not making any silly little mistakes, we multiply both sides by 4 over 13. 4 divided by 2 is 2, and when we go to the second term on the right-hand side, the 4s are going to cancel out, giving us a coefficient of 3 over 13, and now we know that the indefinite integral of e to the 2x cosine of 3x dx is equal to 2 over 13 times e to the 2x times cosine of 3x plus 3 over 13 times e to the 2x sine of 3x plus c. I'm Mr. Tarrou. Bam! Go to your...